Hi everyone, in this episode we're going to be looking at the vector structs, which we use to store things like positions, velocities, and directions. When we're working in three-dimensional space, we need three values to define a vector, one for the x-axis, one for the y, and one for the z. This is called a vector 3. When we're working in 2D space and no longer require the z-axis, we can switch to using a vector 2 instead. Let's take a brief look at vectors. So say I define a vector 2 with an x value of negative 4 and a y value of 3. The usual definition of a vector states it as a quantity having direction, as well as magnitude, or in simple terms, length. We can calculate the magnitude using the theorem of Pythagoras. So in this case, the magnitude is equal to the square root of negative 4 squared plus 3 squared, which is simply 5. To calculate the direction of the vector, we have to normalize it. To do this, we just have to divide both the x and y values by the magnitude. So negative 4 over 5 equals negative 0.8, and 3 over 5 equals 0.6. The significance of what we've just done is that if we were to calculate the magnitude of this direction, square root negative 0.8 squared plus 0.6 squared, we'd get a value of 1. As a practical example of why this is important, say we create a vector 2 from the player's input. Now imagine the player is holding down the left and up key, so we have an input vector of negative 1x and 1y. Now, say we want to move the player object a distance of 3 units in that direction, so we multiply this input vector by 3, giving us negative 3 by 3. We then move the player object negative 3 units on the x-axis and 3 units on the y-axis. But if we now measure the distance the player has moved, we can see that it's about 4.2 instead of the 3 we intended. The mistake we've made has allowed the player to travel faster when moving diagonally, and it's a pretty easy mistake to make, so remember, if you want to treat a vector as a direction, you're going to have to normalize it first. I find it helpful to think of a normalized vector as fitting perfectly inside of a unit circle. Our unnormalized input vector with a value of negative 1x, 1y clearly lies outside of the circle, whereas if we normalize it by dividing it by its magnitude, that being root 2, it will have a value of approximately negative 0.71 and 0.71 lying along the circumference of the circle. Now, because vectors conveniently define an x, y, and, in the case of the vector 3, a z value, we use them in programming to define not only directions and velocities, but also simply a point in space. Say we have a vector representing the current position of the player object at, say, negative 4 and 1, and then another vector representing the position of an enemy object over here at maybe 2 and 3. Now, if we were to subtract the enemy's position from the player's, we'd end up with a new vector of negative 6x, negative 2y. Considering this new vector as a position would be fairly meaningless. However, considered as the displacement between the player and the enemy, it can be very useful. Its magnitude is the distance between the two, and if we normalize it, we get the direction from the enemy towards the player. Both of these, of course, are very useful things to be able to calculate. The vector structs vector 2, vector 3, and even vector 4 already exist as part of the Unity library, which we're given access to by the line using Unity Engine at the top of our code. Now you might be wondering what a struct is. So structs are similar to classes in that they act as a container for some code. There are some important differences between the two, but we're mostly going to worry about those in a later episode. I like to think of structs as a way of grouping related variables together to form a single custom variable type. Say, for example, that we have an enemy class, which needs to keep track of a vector for its current velocity, and a vector for the position of the target it's chasing. We could have six float variables, three defining the velocity, and three defining the target's position. By creating a vector struct, however, which groups together these x, y, and z floats, any time that we need to represent a set of three numbers, we can simply use our custom vector variable. So in this example, the velocity and target position can each be represented by a single vector 3 variable. Inside the vector struct would be a bit of code called the constructor. We'll talk about this in detail when we look at structs properly later on in the series, but this basically enables us to set the values inside the vector by writing equals new vector 3, open parentheses, followed by the values for each of the axes separated by commas, and then closing parenthesis and a semicolon for the end of the line. We can also get or set the values of the x, y, and z axes individually by writing, for example, velocity dot x equals 5. Unity's implementation of the vector structs also contains some handy shortcuts for getting things like a vector's magnitude or the normalized value of a vector, so we don't have to worry about doing the maths for that ourselves. As a last note, I would like to talk about what sort of operations are defined for vectors. We can multiply a vector by a number, which has the effect of multiplying each of the individual axes by that number, and the same goes for division. We can also add two vectors together, which simply adds the like axes together, x plus x, y plus y, and so on. Here, the same obviously applies with subtraction. These are the only basic operations that are defined for Unity's vector structs: multiply or divide a vector by a number, and add or subtract two vectors. Fancier operations like the dot and cross product we'll discuss in a later video. For now, we've learned some of the basics about vectors and how they're represented in our programming, so next video we'll be able to put this knowledge to good use, doing cool things like making a cube move around our game world and having a sphere chase after it. I'll see you then. Cheers.